Well, good morning. It is a super day, isn't it? Right. Hey, you know what? It's Easter, people. Every Sunday is Super Bowl Sunday, and we know that we are winners through faith in Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. My name is Pastor Kyle Blake. I am one of the pastors here at Bethany. I'm going to be preaching for you today. Pastor Seth is going to be leading our liturgy. Kaylee's going to be doing our children's message. It's a blessing and an honor and a privilege to be worshiping with you here this morning. It is our tradition here at Bethany to stand during the first hymn, and typically when we have a crucifer and an acolyte, they come in the back, but we don't have one of those, but we are looking for them. So if any one of you, doesn't matter what age you are, right, would like to be a crucifer or acolyte on Sunday morning, well, usually it's like high school and above or junior high and above, so let's do it that way. I know we have some younger ones who'd love it, but hey, but you 80-year-olds, we're good, right? Let's do it. Let's get her done. All right. But we do want to welcome you to worship this morning, and I invite you to stand as we sing our first hymn.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We continue with our litany on the top of page 4. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. All things were created by him and for him. In him, all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Christ and reconcile all things to himself, all things in heaven and on earth, and to provide peace in all things through Jesus' blood. You may be seated.
Good morning. Our first scripture reading is recorded in the Old Testament book of Jeremiah, chapter 17. In the previous chapter, God has been speaking to Jeremiah, and God wants Jeremiah to tell the children of Israel what he said. This is what the Lord says. Cursed is the person who trusts humans, who makes flesh and blood his strength and whose heart turns away from the Lord. He will be like a bush in the wilderness. He will not see when something good comes. He will live in the dry places in the desert, in a salty land where no one can live. Blessed is the person who trusts the Lord. The Lord will be his confidence. He will be like a tree that is planted by water. It will send its roots down in the heat of the summer. It will not be afraid in the heat of the summer. Its leaves will turn green. It will not be anxious during droughts. It will not stop producing fruit. Here ends the reading. Our second reading is recorded in Paul's first letter to the Christians at Corinth, chapter 15. If we have told you that Christ has been brought back to life, how can some of you say that coming back from the dead is impossible? If the dead can't be brought back to life, then Christ hasn't come back to life. If Christ hasn't come back to life, our message has no meaning, and your faith also has no meaning. In addition, we are obviously witnesses who lied about God because we testified that he brought Christ back to life. But if it's true that the dead don't come back to life, then God didn't bring Christ back to life. Certainly, if the dead don't come back to life, then Christ hasn't come back to life either. If Christ hasn't come back to life, your faith is worthless, and sin still has you in its power. Then those who have died as believers in Christ no longer exist. If Christ is our hope in this life only, we deserve more pity than any other people. But now, Christ has come back from the dead. He is the very first person of those who have died to come back to life. Here ends the second reading.
Good morning. I invite all children to come forward for the children's message. You just come sit right here. Yep, right there. Perfect. I like your shirt. It's going to go well with today's message. Good morning. All right, I think we have a few more coming down. Yep. Don't color on the ground, nope. All right, how are you two? Come sit over here. All right, so I brought two things with me today. I brought two branches. They're from the same plant. They're from one of the palm trees that we have here on campus. Can somebody tell me what the difference between these two branches is? What's one of the differences? All right, this one's fading and the other one's not. Henry? Yeah, it's a weird color. So one's green, one is a grayish, brownish, yellowish. What's another? All right, one is doing fine, one's living, the other one's kind of dying. Do you have any other differences? All right, you guys got it right. This one's all brittle. Feel that one. Does that feel good? No. Okay, so this one's kind of soft and kind of weird feeling too, but this one, is it brittle and dead? Yeah. Here, feel the difference. Which one do you like better? Do we like the green one or the dying one? You like the dying one? Henry, this is not how this message is supposed to go. All right, come here, Zeb, you want to touch them? Let's see, which one do you like better? You like the green one? Why do you like the green one better? Feels softer. This one's kind of, yeah. All right. Well, Henry, let's see if I can turn this around. All right. So we just heard somebody read for us from the book of Jeremiah. All right. And I want to read two lines from it. All right. So the first one says, "Cursed is a man who trusts in man." Does that sound good? No. All right, let's read another one. "Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord." Does that sound better? Yeah. Which would you rather be, cursed or blessed? Blessed, right. Well, the book of Jeremiah, we are told that we're kind of like these leaves. So the first part where it says, "Cursed is a man who trusts in man," says that if you trust in man only, you might have some issues. Right? You might not grow, you might struggle, you might have some problems, but if you trust in God and walk with God, we know that God's gonna help us. We can grow strong, and we can be alive and living. And so we're kind of like this when it comes to God. Does God strengthen us? Yeah, definitely. Does God help us to grow? Definitely. All right, and so Jeremiah tells us that we should put our trust in the Lord. Is God trustworthy? Do we know that God is going to take care of us? Do we know that God is going to love us? He's going to help us? How do we know? How do we know he's always going to be there for us, loving us? Yeah. He loves us. Yeah, we can just feel that. We know that. What else? Has God done anything for us to let us know that we can trust him? What has he done? He bless us, perfect. Oh, and he died on the cross for us. And do we know that we can trust him because he sent his son to save us? Yeah, definitely. So, which branch would you guys like to be like? Yes, the green one. Raise your hand if you want to be a green branch. All right, Henry, raise your hand if you want to be a brown branch. No. You want the green one now? You've changed your tune? All right. So, we know that with the Lord, we can grow, we can be strengthened, we can walk with him. But above all, we know that we can trust his love and his kindness because he has given us salvation and eternal life, right? All right, do you guys want to pray with me? All right, we're going to have the congregation join in as well. So let's go ahead and fold our hands and you can repeat after me. Dear Lord, help us to walk with you, to be rooted in you, and to grow in you. Remind us that you love us, that you have saved us, and you will always be with us. We love you, Lord. In your name we pray. And all God's people said, Amen. All right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, thank you very much for coming up. You can go back now.
From Luke's Gospel, today we read a portion of the sixth chapter. Jesus came down from the mountain with them, that is the disciples, and stood on a level place. A large crowd of his disciples and many other people were there. They had come from all over Judea, Jerusalem, and the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon. They wanted to hear him and be cured of their diseases. Those who were tormented by evil spirits were cured. The entire crowd was trying to touch him because power was coming from him and curing all of them. Jesus looked at his disciples and said, "Blessed are those who are poor. God's kingdom is theirs. Blessed are those who are hungry. They will be satisfied. Blessed are those who are crying. They will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, avoid you, insult you, and slander you, because you are committed to the Son of Man. Rejoice then and be very happy. You have a great reward in heaven. That's the way their ancestors treated the prophets. But how horrible it will be for those who are rich. They have had their comfort. How horrible it will be for those who are well fed. They will be hungry. How horrible it will be for those who are laughing, for they will mourn and cry. How horrible it will be for you when everyone says nice things about you. That's the way their ancestors treated the false prophets." A reading from the Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
I got a question for you this morning. When you heard the gospel lesson or when you were reading along with it in your bulletin, I mean, How did it hit you? How did you hear it? Was it good news, right? I mean, if you pull out your bulletin again and look at it, we're on page 5, and it talks about, you know, Jesus coming down from the mountain. He had been up on the mountain, and the Lord had kind of, like, you know, through prayer said, these are the 12 guys, so he chose these 12 guys to follow him. But he's got a lot of disciples that are following him at the time. If you remember in Luke, he sends out the 72, right? And so you've got 12, you've got 72, you just got a bunch of people that hang around Jesus. And as he comes down, he sees all of these people that are surrounding him. And it says the people are from Jerusalem, Judea, Tyre, Sidon. And if you looking at this particular text and getting a little bit of geography going on, Jerusalem and Judea are like in the south, right? The Sea of Galilee is in the north. I know some of you guys have been there, so you've actually seen that. I haven't had the pleasure to do that yet, but, you know, indulge me for a second. They're on the north side of the Sea of Galilee. And so you've got people from Jerusalem and Judea traveling some 100+ miles to see and to hear and to experience this Jesus character that everybody talks about. Now, he comes down from the mountain and there's a crowd of people kind of gathered around, right? And it's a really nice, subtle crowd, right? Everybody's just kind of sitting and chilling and just paying attention and listening. I don't know about that one. So, you know, if you look at this, right, it says that there's people who are coming to be cured of their diseases. It's saying that people are coming with demons to be cast out. And if you read throughout the New Testament, let's stop for a second and see the demons, right? If you read through the New Testament, you see guys who are possessed by the demons and they are like convulsing, they're naked, they're breaking chains, they're flying. I mean, so you can imagine there's some of these folks in the crowd, right? It's not, you know, you're kind of like, oh my goodness, this is crazy to the nth degree, right? And then on top of that, you've got people with diseases and needing cure. They've tried all the doctors of the land and they can't be cured. And who are some of the people that Jesus cured in Scripture, right? He opened the eyes of the blind. He opened the ears of the deaf. He cured people with leprosy. The unclean ones. I mean, who are some of the people that Jesus hung out with? Sinners, tax collectors, and they're all sitting there in one big crowd, wanting to see and hear and experience Jesus. And it says that he began to heal them. And I don't know if it was like the disciples started organizing, be like, okay, the line of lepers, you stay over there. All the demon possessed, you go right here, right? If you're blind, hey, we're over here, right? I mean, I kid, but it must have been pretty chaotic. Have you ever been in a mosh pit? But think about it, right? People are wanting to touch Jesus. People are wanting to come near to him. People know that he brings healing. So it's a little bit of craziness, and it says that he's healing people and the power is going out from him, and people are doing all they can to get near him. It says the entire crowd was trying to touch him because power was coming from him and curing all of them. And so people are seeing and hearing and experiencing Jesus. And I'm gonna guess that a lot of these people were pretty broken, whether it be physically, mentally, emotionally, and just spiritually. And after kind of the healing takes place, it says that, you know, Jesus began to talk to his disciples and teach them. He began to preach to his disciples, and everyone around them heard ear. Now, the preaching that we find in Luke chapter 6, a lot of commentators believe is the same sermon that he preached in Matthew 5 through 7, the Sermon on the Mount. Now, I know, you know, to go down a little bit of a rabbit trail, a lot of you guys might go home and pick up Matthew 5 and Luke 6 and start flipping back and forth and going like, well, wait a minute, these sermons, they don't add up. They're not the same thing. I mean, there's a lot of the same similarities, but over here he says this in Matthew, and over here he says this in Luke, and here's the test. Tomorrow I'm going to call some of you, and I'm going to ask you exactly every word I said in today's sermon. And you can't watch the tape. you're not going to remember it the same way, right? Some of you guys are going to hear certain things. Some of you guys are going to hear another. To be honest with you, as preachers, sometimes people come up to us after the service and they're like, hey, I really like that you said this. And I'm thinking, I never said that. I also know that some of you are reading the chimes right now and you're not even paying any attention to me whatsoever anyway. My point is that two people can hear the same sermon and get two things out of it. And Matthew was probably there because he was one of the disciples. Luke gathered the teachings, and he was probably at some of these things, but not at all these things. And he heard from different people who were there. And they were writing to two different audiences as well. But as we read over this text, we begin to notice that after Jesus is teaching, he stands up, or after he's healing, he stands up and he starts to teach. And the first thing that he does, the first thing that Luke records is this contrast. He talks about those who are poor and hungry and distraught. And he kind of like, you know, compares them with those who are rich and well-fed and happy. Now, when you heard that this morning, when you read that, whether it be for the first time or for the 500th time, how did it hit you? What did you find yourself paying attention to? Now, I mean, there might be some of us who've been like, oh, well, I'm good, man. I'm poor and I'm hungry and I'm distraught. And there might legitimately be someone like that in here. But for the majority of us, the great majority of us, if we begin to compare ourselves to, let's say, I don't know, the rest of the world, right, where the average per capita income in the world is about $10,000, a little over $10,000, I'm going to guess we're probably on the other side of that, right? And if you look at me, you know that I never went hungry a day in my life. And in fact, I'm really kind of looking forward to not looking forward to literally gorging myself. It's like my second Thanksgiving Super Bowl, right? Because there's going to be so much food. It's going to be a cornucopia. And so the reality of being hungry and poor is not something that a lot of us, if not most of us, I would say a majority of us in this place actually know. And so if we're not the ones, the poor that he's talking to, then are we the rich? Is this a woe is me text? So what's going on here? Well, I believe that to get into this Luke chapter 6 text, we actually need to go back. And not back to the beginning of Luke, but actually back to the beginning of Scripture. Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3. And it's in Genesis 1, 2, and 3 that you find the creation of the world, right? He created the world in how many days? 6 days. Oh, people are like, oh, he asked questions. And on the seventh day, he rested. On the sixth day, he created man, right? And then he created woman, you know, from man and Adam and Eve. And you had Adam and Eve in the garden. And what do we know? If you've been around church for any amount of time, you probably know this a little bit. What do we know about Adam and Eve pre-fall, before they sinned? What do we know about Adam and Eve pre-fall? They were happy, right? They're content. Everything was good, right? They are living in the world with God. They were walking with God every single day. They were not experiencing sadness or sickness or hunger. They depended and trusted fully on God. They were walking around naked, right? They had no pride. It was like, whatever, right? I'm not worried about it. They knew that they owned nothing. That these things that were created that were good were for them, but they were called to be stewards of those things. It didn't belong to them. They weren't like, that's my tree. Eve, you can't touch my tree, right? They knew it was all God's. So with that in mind, take a look at our text again today. Typically, when people are poor or hungry or broken, typically, who do they depend on for help? They depend on others. They depend on God. They depend on others, right? They depend on people that have been put in their lives by God to provide for those needs that they have. Those of us with means to provide and to care for those who might find themselves poor or hungry or broken. But when people are more rich or well-fed or comfortable, who do they tend to depend on? Themselves. And we see this comparison in our society, don't we? When a lot of times we might be guilty of the fact that when we look at somebody who's poor, well, if they would just work harder like I do, then they would have what I have. If they would just pull themselves up by their bootstraps, they could figure it out. I worked hard for everything I have, right? Well, in our text today, Jesus is teaching his disciples that the kingdom of God is like life before the fall, before sin. But before man turning in on himself, Jesus is pointing the disciples to a life that fully depends on and trusts in God to provide everything we need in body, mind, and soul. And to know that he's going to provide that through others around us, through the people that he puts around us and where we live, learn, labor, or laugh. Because before the fall, that's the way it was. But after the fall, when sin entered the world, with sin came pride and self-reliance. Humanity started to depend on its own skills and ability to focus on its own desires and comfort and sought its own glory. It's no longer about God and others. It's about me. Think about it. What does the world teach you to value? Where does it tell you to find your identity in? Money, fame, power, your own self-ability inside of yourself. It's about what you have, what you do, and who you are in this world. It doesn't matter who you have to step on to get it. The world's concern for others only goes as far as much as others can help me achieve money and fame and power. What can you do for me? I'd even say that if you watch our 24-hour news cycle, we're taught that two of the greatest achievements in life are to be comfortable and to be safe. I just want to be comfortable. I just want to be safe. We're taught from a very young age to fear the other. Those people over there. And those people are attacking my comfort and my safety. Now, when one compares this to total dependence on God for provision, comfort, identity, and loving your neighbor as yourself, you can start to see a kind of a radical difference, can't you? I mean, the reality is that as we start to seek after Jesus, as we begin to live in the kingdom of God, as we seek to follow Jesus, to obey him, to do what he calls us to do, and everything, in all things, everyone around us might begin to think we're a little crazy at times. I mean, you might start seeing people really kind of say, hey, I want to be totally dependent on God and stop worrying about stuff here on earth, money, fame, and power. Yes, I want to work in the vocations that God has put me in. And some of those vocations, right? Some of those vocations provide a good living and a great income. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with being wealthy. But what do you do with that? Is it about God has given me the ability to work in this vocation so I can work and provide stuff and help others out? Maybe you begin to give stuff away to downsize a little bit. Maybe you start to realize that the kingdom of God is really about bringing the good news of Jesus Christ to all people, and not just people I'm comfortable with being around. You want to see all people's lives made new, creation recreated, people being made whole, sins forgiven, outcasts becoming family, wounded healed, evil overcome, so that God can get glory through it all. Maybe you'll find yourself being called to open your lives to some pretty sketchy people. People that might seem unsafe or unwelcomed. And you begin to realize that no matter what we go through, no matter what we endure, no matter what the Lord allows to be in our lives, that we have the victory because Christ has been crucified and risen again. Christ is risen.
He is risen.
And that becomes our hope. Christ crucified and risen. And I can tell you that people might even go as far as hating you for living like that, to avoiding you, to insulting you, to slandering you, because you're living outside of the world's ways. Think about it. I mean, you meet somebody that might be like really joyful and they're legitimately joyful in the midst of affliction, and you're like, dude, you're crazy. I don't want anything to do with you. You're just too happy too much of the time. Because that person goes against the norm. But we have to realize the norm in our world is broken. You see, Jesus came to smash up our norms and make all things new. Jesus, he came to set us free, to make us new, to recreate us, to restore us into a right relationship with the Father. He came to live and to die and to rise again so that your sins and mine might be forgiven, that we would be healed and made whole, that our shame and our guilt would be taken away, that those of us who feel like outsiders know that we are part of a greater family, the family of God. He has overcome sin and death and the power of the devil, and through faith in him, he binds up our brokenness, he heals our hopelessness, and he reveals our true identity in him. He gives us peace in the midst of persecution, joy in our hearts and lives, no matter what might happen around us. As we learn to trust in him, to draw our confidence from him, we begin to be like a tree planted by a river, providing for us living water. So that in times that would normally make us really kind of anxious and afraid, we have joy and peace. In times of drought and heat, we still produce fruit. He teaches us to depend on and trust in him in good times and in bad. Because in this ever-changing world, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And rather than trusting in ourselves and our ability to control, because the reality is we don't have control. The things in this world, the things the world values, the money, the notoriety, the power, they're kind of like a bush in the wilderness, right? They spring up, they might look beautiful for a second, but they're really, really shallowly rooted. And soon, when it's only depending on itself for nourishment, it dies and it just rolls away, leaving us wanting more. You ever see a tumbleweed? I mean, tumbleweeds just don't appear, right? At some point, it was a beautiful plant that just was really shallowly rooted and died and just rolls away. So every time I see a tumbleweed, it reminds me of the Jeremiah passage this morning. I actually also, if you don't know, I have tattoos. I have a tree with roots, and you can see the roots there on my wrist. It's a reminder of me, the Jeremiah passage is all. It's Lord, you know, help me to be rooted in you. Because the reality is that Jesus this morning is inviting us to learn to trust in him, to draw our strength from him, to find our identity in him, and to follow him. He's inviting those of us who are tired and weary from chasing the world's ways and seeking satisfactions that are from things that are here today and gone tomorrow to come and to find true rest in him. He's inviting those of us who struggle with shame and guilt to find forgiveness in him. He's inviting those of us who feel like outsiders and outcasts to be a part of his family. He's inviting those of us who struggle with anxiety and fear to find confidence and hope in him. He's inviting those of us who struggle with our identity to find our true identity in him. He's inviting us to experience the kingdom of God, of his grace, of his mercy, of his peace. And as we do, as we come to him, he calls us not only to come by ourselves, but to invite others around us who we live, learn, labor, and laugh with to do the same. Now you might be asking yourself, well, what does this really look like? I mean, what does it really look like to follow Jesus in all things? What is it? How do I learn to really kind of trust Jesus and draw my strength from him, to find my identity from him, to follow him? How do I walk with people around me and help them do the same? What does it look like to do this as a church or a household or an individual? Well, to you, I say, welcome to Bethany. Because I don't know about you, but I'm struggling right alongside of you. What does this look like for me to do this? What does it look like to lead the households of faith that I'm involved with to do this? What does it look like to even lead the church to do this? And I believe that we as a congregation have been on this journey together, struggling with this as we go along, as we talk about in all things, as we look at the Bethany blueprint and look like, what does it look like to follow Jesus in these things and allow him to fill us with his love and his mercy and his grace? And we've been encouraging individuals to wrestle alongside of us as we read books like, you know, the Robert Mulholland book we just read, and the book we're reading currently, or the book we're going to read. And we're during Lent, we're going to talk about how do we as households wrestle with this and walk alongside of each other. And we're not just talking about the people under your roof. We might be talking about a household at work or a household at school. And don't worry, we'll do a little bit better defining in that, right? But as we wrestle together, my prayer is that Jesus continues to open our eyes, that people are comforted, that the captives get set free, that outsiders become part of the body, and that the body of Christ is strengthened and grow, and that you and I might grow closer to Jesus and to one another. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We continue with the music.
We join with Christians around the world confessing our faith together. This morning we use the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. I invite you to rise for prayer as you are able. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. For our synodical president, Pastor Matthew Harrison, for our district president, Pastor Mike Gibson, for all pastors in Christ, for all servants of the church, and for all the people, let us pray to the Lord. For President Biden, for all public servants, for the government and those who protect us, that they may be upheld and strengthened in every good deed, let us pray to the Lord. For those who work to bring peace, justice, health, and protection in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord. For those who bring offerings, those who do good works in this congregation, those who toil, those who sing, and all the people here present who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord. For favorable weather, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For our deliverance from all affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord. For the sick, for those recovering from surgery or procedure, including Claude Potter, Doug Crawford, Grace Hennings, Ron Miner, Don Maxwell, let us pray to the Lord. For all those who mourn, including the young family at the death of their grandson, let us pray to the Lord. O God, from whom come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We are grateful for the offerings that you continue to give to the ministry here. If you brought a gift with you, you can leave it in the box, which is in the center aisle there. You can also use online giving. Information is in the bulletin about that. Or you can mail in or drop off your offerings here to the office anytime. We pray. Abundant God, we give you our thanks for your continual provision for us and for all creation. Stir up your spirit in us that we might recognize these gifts, be thankful for them, and share your abundance. In Jesus' name, amen. Just a couple of things as we conclude our time here in God's house. We have a number of things happening in the days and weeks ahead. Out in the courtyard, I have an opportunity to support our golf tournament, which is coming up in March. Information about that is in Chimes, along with lots of other things as well. It's kind of hard to believe, but just in a few weeks, we are going to begin the season of Lent with Ash Wednesday. And during the Sundays in Lent, we're going to be focusing on households of faith. Pastor Kyle kind of talked a little bit about what a household might consist of. We're going to be spending 5 weeks talking about households of faith. And really, you might be surprised at how God really defines a household. It's a little bit different than you might think. But today, in households across America, people are going to be gathering for the big game. Now, I don't know what's more important to you in the big game, whether it is the game itself, whether it is the commercials, the halftime show, or just the snacks. At some point, as you're watching the game, you're going to be seeing the players huddle up. A huddle is where the team is told the play, they're reminded of the patterns and the roles, and they're encouraged to reach the goal. At some point, one of the teams is going to be celebrating probably some of those plans that were in the huddle. It might not be the team you want, or it might be the team that you want. But huddling is a really important way to find success. This Lenten season, we would hope that within your households of faith, you would find ways and patterns which you can huddle up with one another. These household huddles are going to be a way in which you can gather once a week for reflection on God's Word, to pray for one another, to bless one another, and to ponder how your household might move together for the sake of others. And in fact, maybe how your household might huddle up with other households and celebrate what God is doing. Now, when you watch the big game today, there might be a point where they're not going to huddle up, but that usually means that something has gone desperately wrong. You know, we don't want you to have a feeling that you're not supposed to be huddling up, because it means that it's an act of desperation, maybe a time for a Hail Mary. No pun intended, we don't want necessarily for you to be doing Hail Marys in your faith life. We would love for you to be huddling up with your households. During this Lenten season, we're not going to be having our midweek services, but we're going to be asking you to huddle up in your households at some point during the week. We're going to be providing you with some resources for how this pattern will work. They're going to be in the bulletin. They're going to be online. You have lots of opportunities to do that and opportunities for multiple households to huddle up together. All those resources are going to be available for you starting March the 6th, maybe even a little bit before online. If you have any questions, you can feel free to talk to me, Pastor Kevin, Pastor Kyle, Kaylee, Carl, any of us would be happy to talk to you about that. All right, enough of the commercial. You're going to see much better ones later today when you're watching the game. At this point, I'm going to ask you to rise for our blessing and for our closing song. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. Amen. peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.